to suppress the truth so that we don't arise to the occasion of who God's called us to be, to what he's created us for. He wants us to keep the truth down so that we can believe the lies that the enemy's trying to put on us. And God does not want us to believe that lie. Can I hear an amen? Amen. God wants us as men and women of God to walk in total freedom and in the truth. But it's not up to God. It's not up to the devil. It's up to us. What are we going to do? How are we going to walk? How are we going to carry ourselves? What are we going to believe? Because, you know, the enemy can do what he wants. But when you have Jesus and you have the Spirit, the enemy has no power over you. Amen. The only power the enemy has on you is what you give him. That's all he can do, is what you allow in your life. So let's just stop allowing it, amen? Yeah. Let's just speak the truth over our lives. And the truth is this. It's this. It's the Word of God. It's not what I think. It's not what I imagine. It's this. It's not what I see on TV or watch on the news. It's this. This is the truth. Jesus is the truth. Amen. Amen? So whatever the world or whatever the enemy's trying to put on you, whispering to you, let's just not receive it. Laugh at the devil. Just laugh at him. Some of you just need a good laugh. Oh, praise God. We just need a good laugh because, you know, we're all so serious about this life and what the enemy's been doing and, you know, about finances and about this, that. Let's enter into rest in Jesus today. Amen. Suppressing the Truth, the title of my message. And we're going to read out of Romans chapter 1, 18 through 23. So if you stand with me. I like to stand when we're reading the Word because it's just honoring to the Lord, amen? It's His Word. It's titled, God's Wrath on Unrighteousness. Verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Because what we may know of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen. Everybody say clearly. Being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were they thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come into your word, I pray that, Lord, our hearts would be stirred as we sung about with a passion for Jesus. That, Lord, that we would truly let the truth come alive and we would walk in suppressing the lies of the enemy. That, Lord, that none of us would leave this place suppressing the truth, but we would walk in the truth. We'd walk in the power, the love, and the sound mind that you have given it to us by your Spirit. And so, Father, let the truth arise and shine today in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. I want to begin today by telling you one very simple thing. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Let that just sink into him for a minute. Jesus loves you. He loves you so much that in Jeremiah 29:11 it says, "For I know the thoughts I think towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope." Now let that just sink into your spirit today. That the great I am we're singing about, number one, is up there thinking about you. He is God, and he is capable. And he is thinking about you today. His mind is on you. And number two, he has these peaceful thoughts for you. God is not up there thinking about how he can destroy your life. He's got peaceful thoughts for your life. How can we enter into his rest? How we can enter into his healing? How we can enter into the joy of the Lord? That's what God is thinking about for us. He's not up there thinking about, how can I make Delonda's life a little worse today? That's not God. That's not even God. God does not put sickness on people. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
God does not put sickness on people. It's very simple. This is how you know. And you'll never say, well, God did this to me, or God's doing this to me. You'll never proclaim that God's doing it to you. Because when Jesus came to the cross, he took all of our sin to the cross so that we can be forgiven of everything. Amen? He took all of our sickness to the cross. Amen? So that we can be healed of everything. You can read it in Isaiah 53. So, if he sent Jesus to take all our sin and our sickness to the cross, if God was to put sickness on us, that would be like slapping Jesus in the face. So disease does not come from God. It comes from the enemy. So when you're being attacked, don't get mad at God. Get mad at the one doing it to you. And you know, and I'm not of the persuasion that I need to fight the devil. I do not need to fight the devil. I don't have to engage the devil at all. Because he's the devil. I need to engage Jesus. I need to engage him. I give my tithes to the Lord so that he rebukes the devourer for me. Amen. I don't have to engage the enemy. I've got to engage with Jesus. So when I feel something coming on me, I don't have to sit and rebuke the enemy or anything. I just say, Jesus, I'm a tither. I proclaim that to him. I tithe. I bring my tithe to the storehouse. Matter of fact, I have him take it out of my check before I ever see it. We don't have to engage the enemy. Jesus said, it is written. See, Jesus took all his focus off of his situation and he put it all on God. It is written. Man shall not live by bread alone. He went right to the word. He just spoke the word over his life when the enemy came against him. And that's what I want us to do, is to speak the word, engage with Jesus. Know that he's thinking about you. Know that he has a plan. And he's looking, number three, he looks to give you a future and a hope. He's looking to give you a future and hope. And I know that the enemy is out to steal your hope today. He is trying whatever he can to rob people of their hope. Remember, hope is not a wish. Hope is not a wish in Jesus. Okay? Hope is a confident expectation of God's promise, his provision, and his character. So my hope is in Jesus. Not that I'm wishing Jesus would do something. I have a confident expectation he's doing something. Amen. I have a confident expectation that he's at work in me. I have a confident expectation for you that he's working in you. Amen. That God is doing something in all of us because he is up there thinking of us. So God is not up there trying to plan your demise. God is up there trying to help us succeed. You know, it was so incredible when you read in the book of Kings, I think it's either 1 Kings or 2 Kings 17, somewhere in there. But King Ahab, which was an evil king, he brought King Jehoshaphat, and he wanted Jehoshaphat to war with him against somebody. And Jehoshaphat says, well, do you have a prophet that could come and give us a word from the Lord? And so he gets all, Ahab brings all these false prophets in. False prophets are saying, yeah, go to war, you're going to win, it's going to be great, you know, we're going to have victory. Jehoshaphat, he says, do you have a real prophet? And Ahab says, well, there's one guy, but I don't really like him. He never says anything good about me. Jehoshaphat says, go get him. So Micaiah comes in. And Micaiah says, yeah, go to war. It's going to be good. And Ahab looks at him and goes, tell us the truth. He said, you shall surely die. And he says, you know, he said, the heavens opened up and I saw Jesus at the throne. And I saw all the hosts of heaven standing with him. And they were strategizing about how to get rid of Ahab because he was so evil. And I think the thing that excites me about that, not that he was trying to get rid of Ahab, but Ahab was very evil, but that God is engaged with the earth. He's strategizing. And his plan was victory for Israel that day. Victory for Israel. God wants to see his people arise and shine. Amen. And he's up there thinking about how he can help you to rise above your current situation. How you can become closer to him. How you can live a life of freedom in Jesus. How you can live and breathe what we've been singing. Because if you sing these songs, man, they are powerful words of declaration about what we're going to do and who he is. So God is planning. In Romans 1:17 it says, right before, you know, because 1:18 I started at, but Romans 1:17 it says, for in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. The righteousness of God is God's way of justifying us sinners, that is putting us in right standing with himself without compromising his absolute pure and moral character. So the only way that God can receive us is under the blood of Jesus. So that when we come to Jesus and we receive what he's done for us and we believe on Jesus Christ, the blood of Jesus covers us and God can receive us into his presence. Can I hear an amen? That we can come in, we can go out, we can be there without him compromising who he is. Now we become righteous by believing in Jesus. You don't become righteous by being a good person. As I was on my way here today, the Lord told me this. He said, you will not get an anointing just because you do the right things. He says, you'll get an anointing from being with him. See, so just being good doesn't make you righteous. Righteousness comes from above, amen? It comes from Jesus, in the blood of Jesus. So, but when we start to live our lives outside of that, outside of the blood of Jesus, outside of believing, outside of being submitted to God, we open ourselves up to trouble. This comes about when we suppress the truth in unrighteousness. When we suppress the truth in unrighteousness, we're moving away from God. We're not moving towards him. And Romans 1, it talks about that in verse 18. It says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. So I want to talk about that today. But number one today, know this. Everyone knows there is a God. I do not believe that an atheist can deny God. He might not want to believe, but everybody knows there is a God. Scripture reveals that. It says his attributes are clearly seen. Creation reveals God. People are without an excuse, the word says. They may not have someone come and preach to them, but God is revealed through creation so that people can't deny that there is a God. I mean, they might say it in their mind, but they know that there's something out there, and they just haven't figured out what it was. In China, we visited, Pastor Jesse and I, visited the Heavenly Temple. That's me holding up the door. And that is the Heavenly Temple there in China. And what they would do is at harvest time, they would come and they would sacrifice there to the unknown God for a good harvest. That's what they did. Now, they had other gods that they sacrificed to, but there was the unknown God also. And that just reminded me as I was looking at this picture this week, and I was thinking about Paul on how he went to a place in Acts chapter 17, verse 22. And it says, then Paul stood in the midst of Areopagus and said, men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are very religious. For I was passing through, considering the objects of your worship, and I even found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God. Therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing, him I will proclaim to you. See, everybody knows there's a God. They may not know him personally, but they know there's something out there, something up there that has done all this. Now, people may lie to themselves and think we come from a Big Bang thing. You know, I'm sure it was a Big Bang when God said, hey, let there be light. I'm sure there was an explosion that happened, amen. When he separated the firmaments, the water, the firmament above, the firmament beneath. I bet there was a bang happening. We did come from dirt. You know, he just scraped that mud together and he made Adam. And then he said, he took that rib out of my side here and gave it to the Londa. He said, this is the one for you. And then he goes on. He says, God, verse 24, who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands, nor is he worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, since he gives all life breath. In all things, we sang of that breath today. Your breath, Lord. We sing of it. And he said, and he's made us from one blood, every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and their boundaries of their dwellings. Yeah, it was pre-appointed that we would be born in, I would be born here in America. I was going to say we, but I don't know if y'all were born in America, you know. Some of you were born in Mexico. Some of you maybe the Philippines. Some of you, you know, maybe Indonesia, you know. So, you know, it doesn't, but God, that's where God puts you. And let me tell you, you need to thank God that you were born here. Amen? Amen. I was talking with Pastor Alfred, our African pastor, this week. And he says, Pastor Ron, he said, well, they call me Bishop. It's kind of fun. Bishop, do you know anything about building wells in Africa? I said, well, I mean, I know there's people that do it, but I don't know them. And he says, well, could you look into it? And I said, sure, what's up? And he goes, well, there's so many villages that have dirty water. And that's why they get sick. I said, really? He said, yeah. And I said, how far do you go to get water? Because I was in his home, and it was a little brick thing, little tin roof. I didn't see any water. I said, how far do you have to go to get water? Oh, Bishop, I got to go 7 miles to get water. I'm like, 7 miles? He said, yeah, somebody will take me on their motorbike. And they have these yellow jugs. You see them all over in China, yellow jugs. And they fill them up. I'm like, sounds like you need a well. He goes, oh, Bishop, I just don't like to ask for myself. If I want to build anybody a well, I'm going to build him a well. Amen? You know, I'm thinking, you know, to build him a church. But I think, man, what would you rather have, a church building or a well? I'd rather have a well. I'd rather have water. So you're here in America. You can just walk out to the bathroom there and turn the faucet on, and what do you expect to come out? And when it doesn't, what are you going to do? You're going to complain to me. Hey, the water's not coming out. Aren't you paying the bill? They don't got lights. I said, what do you do with that money I send you? He goes, well, Bishop, we need gas. I said, what do you need gas for? Well, for the generator. We can't, you know, we have to have a generator because they don't have electricity. They have to have a generator to make their musical instruments. I mean, we bought them a brand new keyboard when we were there in January. He's like, I gotta have a generator to make it all work. So, you know, I don't give much tithes and offerings, but what I get, I have to buy gas. He said, Bishop, it's not like where you live. I said, I know, man. I know. He says, I can't wait to come to America one day. And I'm thinking, you're not coming here, man. You come here, you won't want to go back. I was in Peru one time, and they had these real rickety pews. I mean, you sat down, you wobbled a little bit, you know. And they had one chair, which they gave to me. Probably thought, that guy will break the pew, you know. They gave me a chair. And I just sat there. I said, oh, Lord, we are so spoiled in America. And the Lord told me this. He says, no, you're not. He said, you are blessed. America is blessed. And I believe that we're blessed because of what we do for the mission field. That we have sent millions and millions of dollars, billions of dollars to the mission field. We have sent people out around the world to proclaim the gospel so that they not only get to see it, but they get to hear it in the name of Jesus. And we can be like Paul, who went to the place, who went to the heavenly temple in the middle of China and is able to go there and say, let me tell you about the unknown God. You were born here for purpose. You're born for a reason in America. You're here for a reason, for God's purpose. You're not here by chance. You're not here just to live a great life. You're here because God has chosen you to be here, to be able to do all the things that He's called you to do. To not have to get a motorcycle ride 7 miles to get water. That you walk from your couch to your faucet in the kitchen and you got water. I remember Delanda was in Guatemala one time and she's holding this little girl and this little girl's got lice jumping out of her hair and everything, you know. Delanda just didn't care. She's just holding this little girl and she's thinking, oh, Lord, I want to take her home with me. And the Lord said, why? So she could be like you guys? She doesn't know what she's missing right now. You take away all our electricity and all our water and stuff, and we'll just roll over and die. Man, there, you know, you go to these other places, they're going to start digging a hole. Pre-appointed times and boundaries of their dwellings so that they, here it is, so that they should seek the Lord. In the hope that they might grope for Him and find Him. Though He is not far from each one of us. He's not far. For in Him we live and move and have our being, as also some of your own poets have said. For we are also His offspring. Therefore, since we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, something shaped by art and man's devising. Truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked. But now, everybody say now, commands all men everywhere to repent. Because He has appointed a day on which He will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom He has ordained, Jesus. He has given assurance of this to all by raising Him from the dead. So, I mean, we're not here just by chance. We're here so that we might seek the Lord in the hope that we might grope for Him and find Him. Man, well, I remember when I brought my Chinese son over here. He's not really my son. Delon and I just adopted this guy. He was about 25 years old, and I met him, and he just, His English name is Timothy. He calls me Paul, or he calls me Dad. And he goes everywhere with me when I'm in China. But he came to America once, and he stood right here, and he shared on a Wednesday night. And, you know, they just look and they marvel at what we have. Wow. And they think, what we could do with something like this, it's just amazing. So with the understanding of who God is, the wrath is poured out because of, number two, knowing God and choosing not to worship Him. This is the kind of thing that stirs God up. He's a jealous God. He wants to be worshipped by us. Amen. He created us and would like us to commit to worshiping Him. But there are negative consequences to those who choose not to worship God, who choose to reject God, who choose to do their own thing. And so I just came up with a list of maybe why we reject to worship God. A, I'm in an outline. A is selfish desires. I love it that if we come to church every week, but when we don't, why don't we come? I don't come because it's my job. I came here long before it was my job, every Sunday, Sunday morning, Sunday night, long before it was my job, because, man, I just want to be with God and His people, amen? I want to rub shoulders with the people of God and glorify God, amen? I want to worship Him with all my heart, my soul, my mind. So it's selfish desires that keep us from it. And then B, I put, not wanting to change. You don't have to raise your hand on this, but how many of you have ever just had something that you just didn't want to change about yourself, but you knew it wasn't right? You didn't have to raise your hand. But it's true. We have things in us that we don't want to change. And C, we like what we're doing. We like what we're doing. Sin is fun for a moment. For a moment. And then D, our flesh is ruling. Our flesh has the rule. And it's controlling us. Or E, we tune out God's voice. We tune out His voice. Well, it's just like, it reminds me of the Israelites when they were in the wilderness at Mount Sinai. And they told Moses, you go up and you hear from God. And you come back and tell us what He said. Because to go up and hear from God is a crazy thing for people. We've been working on hearing the voice of God on Wednesday nights and prophesying to each other. And it's been incredible as people are prophesying and ministering each other on Wednesday nights. The power of God is just transforming us. Because we're encouraging one another in hearing from heaven. And when we do that, when we can hear from heaven so clearly, and we stop tuning out the voice of God, we're going to be able to walk more in the Spirit and not in our flesh. Amen? That's what Galatians says. He says, walk in the Spirit so you don't fulfill the lust of your flesh. And we do that, walking in the Spirit, by hearing from heaven and knowing, what is He saying? But if you're not hearing from heaven, then you do what you want. And I've been married, as long as it's 35. I was going to say almost 36 years. And two girls growing up, I was growing up, they were growing up, because we were young. We had our first one at 21, second one at 23. And so, we were still young and kids growing up with us. But just let me know I'm not alone in this, guys. There are times when I tone out my wife and I'm not really listening. Now, I know Al Jones doesn't do that. But guys, am I alone? Did any of you ever tune out your wife and don't listen? Thank you, brother. I got... All right, Bob. Yeah. Now, you ladies can tune us out too. Amen, yes. So, if we can do that to each other, don't you think we can do that to God too? See, but we tune God out, Pastor Jesse, I think because we're not so sure that he's speaking to us. You know, when he tells you to, you shouldn't be here, you think, oh, that's just me. I'm okay. It's all right. I'm okay here. But when he's telling you, get up and go out of this place, you're like, that seems weird. You're at the movie theater and you're watching a movie that you know you shouldn't be watching it. And God says, you need to get up and leave. And you're like, I just paid $12 for this movie. He can't expect me to leave. I remember when Delon and I went into one movie and we sat down and this guy walked out naked and we were like, well, we're up and out of here, man. We ran out of that theater, you know. And got our money back. She's like, man, this is a PG movie. We didn't expect that. And she said, give us our money back. And I'm like, yay, man. You know, yay. But you know, what will people think if I get up and I leave this movie? What will people think if I paid $80 to go to this concert, but it's so vile that I shouldn't be there? What will my family say if I get up and leave right now? Because they are just being crazy. And it's affecting my spirit. How many of you got family members like that, huh? And they're like, oh, there goes the holier than thou one. So we don't listen to God because we don't want to offend anybody else. You need to get in the mode of offending people. Do explain, Delonda says, for the right things. You know, we're so afraid to tell people about Jesus because we're afraid we might offend them. Oh, they might get upset. Well, they might go to hell if you don't tell them.
That's right.
Offense, hell, you know. Well, my family hates me. Well, that's okay. Just tell them the truth. I love you. At some point, we got to be real with people, amen? Because Jesus is coming. Last week, before last Sunday, two prophetic words that terror is coming. The first one, I heard it. And I said, is that for an individual or is that a corporate word? You know, is terror coming to just one person or maybe even the lady that gave the word, or is it congregational? 4 days later, I'm actually at a birthday party. I'm at a birthday party and lady says, I have a word for you pastors here today. There's a number of pastors there. She said, terror is coming. But I'm going to give you a double portion anointing that you'll be able to go through this. And you'll be able to bring people through this. I'm like, you know, and then we're sitting on the couch yesterday and that earthquake started. And we're like, is this it? But I'm confident of this. God doesn't judge the righteous with the wicked. I speak that over my life too, amen? But at what point are we going to be really concerned with the people around us that we're not afraid to offend them to tell them about Jesus? We got to wake up to it, amen? What was I talking about? Knowing God and choosing not to worship him. Choosing not to. Whatever the reason, knowing God and choosing not to worship him is going to bring a wrath of God on us. There's a wrath that's going to come that people are going to be under. And I'm sure I've known Christians that feel like they're under the wrath of God. It just means that we pick up God's way of doing things and his way of being right, and we follow after him again, amen? We start worshiping him again. But then there's also not being, number three, not being thankful to God. not being thankful. We're coming up on Thanksgiving. It shouldn't be the only time we're thankful to the Lord, amen? It should be, we should be thanking God all the time. First Thessalonians 5:18, it says this. It says, in everything give thanks. Everybody say thanks. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. This is God's will for your life, that in everything give thanks. Amen? It does not mean that you thank the Lord because you're sick, but you thank the Lord that He's your healer. Amen? You know, it does not mean that you thank the Lord when you get in an accident. It means that you thank the Lord that He's your protector. Amen? It does not mean that you thank the Lord when you don't have any money. You thank the Lord that He's Jehovah Jireh, your provider. Amen? You start speaking who He is over your situation so that you can live a life of thanksgiving. You can find thanks in everything if you just allow yourself to. And I think that's just from walking in the Spirit with God, that you can live a life of thanksgiving instead of being miserable. Are you miserable? You got real quiet on me. But it's learning to give thanks at all times to the Lord. And that takes a shift in our thinking. It takes a shift from the way we've operated to who we want to be in Christ Jesus. It means that we've got to consciously think about giving thanks. And it's only for a season that you've got to consciously think about it, because then it becomes who you are. You're thankful all the time. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 15, it says, for all things, everybody say all. All things are for your sakes, that grace having spread through the many may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. So if your mentality is, well, everything's for my benefit, then you'll learn to find God in all of it. Because if I wreck my car and that's for my benefit, I'm thank you, Lord, that I got to walk. That's not my thinking. Thank you, Lord, that you got a new car for me. Amen? I start rejoicing and finding the good in all of it instead of the bad. Thank the Lord, He's my healer. We can look back at Paul and his life and see how God moved through him in a powerful way. To see how his life was transformed by an encounter with God and a life wholly surrendered to Jesus can be used. He wrote the majority of the New Testament because he just surrendered to Jesus. And God moved through him powerfully. All things are for your sake. So in every look for the gold. Look for the gold. In everything, look for the gold. In the sense that when things are rough and things are bad and you're having a tough time, look for something good. I remember Delonda used to make me watch this movie, Pollyanna. She loves them old movies. She made me watch Pollyanna. You need to go home and rent it. Pollyanna, she played the glad game, and in everything she had to find out something to be glad about in every situation. And she was really good at it for other people. And then something happened to her, and it got really tough to find the good. So you may be an encourager to other people. You may be the one that people call and you encourage and you build them up, but you may be the very one that's the encourager that feels all alone and distraught and distressed and tore up. We need to start encouraging through the mirror. Amen. Look at yourself and say, oh, you are beautiful, you are wonderful, you are a mighty person of God, mighty man of God, mighty woman of God. You are holy, you are the beloved of God. You start declaring it in the mirror to yourself, believing what you're saying to yourself. You shall overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of testimony. God's building a testimony in you today. Hallelujah. But I don't think God's got to build a testimony in us. I don't think that's the only answer, because Jesus, He never sinned. He never went through the junk that we've gone through to get a testimony. He just walked in the power of God, amen? Said, hey, you don't have to do that stuff. I know a man who was in deep turmoil, suffering mentally very bad, was just getting crazy. And he got in a fight with his dad and his brother. Mom had to call the police. They had to tase him. They took him to the mental ward. They asked Alana and I to go visit him, and we went and we visited him. We thought he might be demon-possessed, because normal people don't act like that. So we arranged for him to go see this minister that had a deliverance ministry. And he went in, he sat down, and Dawn and I were there. We just sat in the back of the room praying while he talked with her. And she said, you know, after talking to him for a bit, she said, you know, if you were demon-possessed, I'd cast that thing out and we'd go to lunch. But that's not your problem. She looked at him. She says, do you want to know what your problem is? He said, absolutely. We drove this far. She looked at him. She said, you're an idiot. I'm like, wow. She says, you're an idiot. Because God has been trying to get your attention to worship Him, and you've been looking everywhere else to find it. You've been looking into this Rastafari, you've been looking into this, you've been looking into that, and God has been trying to get your attention. He says, well, will you counsel me? And she says, it's a long drive here. He goes, well, I come by here once a month. And she says, you do? Why do you come by here once a month? He says, well, I buy my pot up here in Northern California, so I come through here. I'm like, you got to be kidding me right now, you know? So this guy comes back. And a week later, he knocks on our door, wants to live with us. I'm like, oh boy. So we said, okay, we're about helping people. So it's like, you got to come to church with us. But he came to the prayer meeting on Friday nights. And prayer meeting Friday nights, man, we pray in tongues like crazy. And he heard us praying in tongues. And he said, that was the most beautiful sound I ever heard. And he committed to Jesus. And he got baptized. And he got filled with the Holy Spirit. But when you're looking in the wrong places, you open yourself up to the wrath of God. When you start going down avenues because God's not meeting or fulfilling your desires right now, and you start looking elsewhere, you open yourself up to the wrath of God. Because the end game here, it says in Romans that they became futile in their thoughts, their hearts were darkened, they worshiped idols. God gives them up to uncleanness. God gives them up to vile passions. They live their lives against the law of nature. This is what happens. And there is a whole movement in America about this right now. That our government is trying to push on us. That it's trying to get everybody to receive this agenda of vileness, of walking away from worshiping God. It's a whole movement in America that's happening, and it's the homosexual agenda that's coming against us right now. It's not of God. That's the result of not worshiping God and not walking in thankfulness. That's the result. I'm just telling you what the book says. This book. This is what God says. So we have to stay in that position of worshiping God. The enemy of your soul will do what he can to get your eyes off Jesus. He knows the Word of God. He knows the history of your family. He knows everything, your family's history, so he knows what worked on your dad. He knows what worked on your grandpa. He knows what worked on your great-grandpa. So he knows what will work against you. And so that's what he throws at you. He'll do what he can to get you to look away from God and get disgruntled with God. The enemy will try and get you to the place that you don't see the value in worship, that you feel like you don't have anything to be thankful for. That's what the enemy will try to do to you. And remember, the devil lies and the devil deceives. Amen? He'll try to cast doubt on whatever truth you know. He'll do what he can. But Jesus has come to give us life. Amen? And life more abundantly. I always like that. But Jesus. Jesus. Yahweh. God is up there thinking about you right now. He wants us to realize how much he loves us and how much he's done for us so that we can walk in that. This life will try to distract you, deter you, and knock you off course. We have to focus on Jesus. And it just takes that we move towards him. Nothing else. Let's move towards Jesus. I don't want Jesus to turn me over to anything in this world. The world is vile and I don't want it. Amen? I don't want any part of it. I want Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. He is the way, the truth, and the life. It's all about Jesus. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we give you praise today. I thank you for your word. And Father, I know that your plan for us is to prosper us and not to harm us, to give us a future and a hope. That you are the way, the truth, and the life. And hallelujah, Father, that Jesus came to give us an abundant life. So, Father, today I know, Lord, that the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. His desire is that we lose heart and we lose hope and we lose focus of who Jesus is so that we don't fulfill the very plan of God on our lives. And I pray that right now, today, that you would just renew our hearts and our minds. And, Lord, that we would suppress the lies and not the truth. Maybe you're here today, you say, Pastor Ron, there's going on in my life that I've been suppressing the truth. I haven't wanted to hear from heaven. I've been selfish. I've been wanting to do my own thing. But I know today I need to get on track. If that's you today, just raise your hand right now. Yeah, amen, 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 amen. Anybody else? Praise God. Why don't we all stand? We're going to take communion here in just a moment. Why don't we just all say this prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for your Son, Jesus. Jesus! Strengthen me today. Help me to not get caught up in the world. Let me be caught up in Jesus. Help me to be in the world, but not of the world. Help me to focus on the things above, on Jesus. that I may bring glory to your name, that I can live for you, that I can be the light of the world, and that you shine through me. Jesus, be my strength. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a clap. We're going to do communion. Robert, if you come, and Scott and Vicky, praise God. The way we do communion is they're going to stand here at the front. You come and get the emblems and then hold on to them. And we'll take it all together in a few moments after everybody's been served. And the only requirement is that you just know Jesus. If you don't know Jesus, just say, well, you've prayed that prayer today. I believe you do now. If you got anything going on in your life that you know is not of God, just confess it to Him and do away with it today in the name of Jesus. Amen. So come as we worship the Lord and get the emblems, and we'll take it together in a minute. Coming back for a bride with spot and wrinkle. Hallelujah. So by the power of the blood of Jesus today, Lord, just wash over us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, unrighteous thinking. Lord, where the enemy's been trying to lay traps, Lord, I pray that you would just snap those traps. Lord, that they'd have no hold on us, that we not get captured into the tricks of the enemy, but we'd walk in the truth of righteousness, of who we are in Jesus. First Corinthians chapter 11 says, when he had given thanks, He says, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. Why don't you just snap that cracker in your hand today? And when he gave thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Let's take and eat. That we could have life. Life is in the blood. Forgiveness of sins is in the blood. Healing is in the blood. Just receive it today. Doesn't matter what you did yesterday. It's where we're going from here. Forgiven, free in Jesus, healed in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray right now, even as we laid hands on the sick today, we come in agreement with your word, Lord, that they be healed. You see, lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. So we pray for a total, complete recover over the people today in the name of Jesus, because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Let's take the cup. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.